You're listening to the audio production of Angels, True Stories by Robert J. Morgan, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Maurice England.
Introduction. All day, all night. When my friend Richard Hendricks was 10 years old, he lived in the small coal mining town of Carbon Hill, Alabama. The Hendricks home sat on the edge of a forest and had a spanning porch where his mother and grandmother worked, peeling apples or snapping beans. Richard loved to play with his friends in the nearby woods, especially around a large overturned pine tree. One day, as the family sat on the porch, a stranger approached. Since Carbon Hill was a small town, everyone knew the neighbors. The man, however, was unknown to them. He displayed Native American features and was toting a rifle. He asked if he could walk around and hunt snakes. Mama ordinarily would have told him to come back when Dad was home, Richard told me. But for some reason, she gave him permission. It seemed as though he belonged there. We felt safe in his presence. The stranger walked straight down to the fallen pine tree, as though he knew where he was going. It was a distance away, out of sight from the house, and no one had mentioned the spot to him. But a few moments later, the air cracked with rifle shots. Shortly, the stranger reappeared with three large rattlesnakes. The largest had 20 rattlers. He had shot them where the children would soon have been playing. The man turned and walked back down the road and was never seen again. "We asked about him," said Richard, "but nobody knew him, and nobody in the neighborhood saw him come or go. If any of us had been bitten by one of the snakes, we wouldn't have survived long enough to get to the hospital 20 miles away. I've always wondered if it was a coincidence or if we saw an angel without realizing it. I might not be alive today if not for this mysterious stranger showing up unannounced at our house that summer day in 1960. Coincidence? Mysterious stranger? Or angel? My files are bulging with stories like this, and many of them appear for the first time in print in this book. Some of these mysterious strangers are undoubtedly ordinary humans who showed up at just the right time in the providence of God. But I believe that others are angels, for the Bible speaks openly of their reality and activity in our world. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2 says, "Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some people have entertained angels without knowing it." This book represents a long-term effort on my part to understand the subject of angels in the teachings of the Bible and the story of Christ in Christian and missionary history and in everyday life. I'm not a speculator or enthusiast. I'm a Bible teacher devoted to rightly dividing the Word of God. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. There's no need to be fanciful or fanatical on this subject, for the Bible provides enough solid data for a satisfying understanding of these mysterious creatures. I'm not sure I've ever seen an angel, but I'm not sure I haven't. In these pages, I want to show you from Scripture and from a handful of first-person accounts what God's angels do and what they do for us. As the hymnist said, "All night, all day, angels watching over me, my Lord." I've seldom studied a topic that so uplifted my spirits. I hope this book will do the same for you. If you have such a story, or you'd like more information about the resources we provide, including a study guide for this book, please contact me at www.robertjmorgan.com. Part 1. Angels. Chapter 1. What the Bible Says About Angels. Dr. Richard Hipps, a friend from Memphis, shared something that happened to his grandmother in 1916. She was about 10, living with her widowed father in Asheville, North Carolina. He worked in the rock quarry. Granny's job, said Richard, was to take lunch to her father every day, but that required crossing a long bridge over the French Broad River. Granny was terrified of that bridge, and one day she was so overcome with fear that she couldn't bring herself to cross it. Sitting at the end of the bridge, she put her head down and began to cry. Suddenly, she heard a voice saying, Honey, if you're afraid to cross the bridge, I'll walk with you. Looking up, she saw a blue-eyed man with a bright countenance. He was holding his horse by the reins. The horse and its rider escorted the little girl over the bridge, and all fear left her. They talked about the beauty of the blue sky and about the Lord's protective care. He told her she didn't need to be afraid anymore. As they approached the end of the bridge, Richard said, Granny turned to thank the man for his company. Before her eyes, both he and his horse vanished. Richard's grandmother continued telling this story into her 80s, and it served to comfort her throughout her life. Now it's a treasured story that has been passed down from generation to generation. This story sounds like so many of the Bible stories I've read since childhood. The Word of God is our primary source of information, the only authoritative and infallible one on the intriguing subject of angels. It's easy to take flying leaps of fancy on this theme, but what does the Bible say? That was my standard when I worked my way through every book of the Bible, tracking down each reference to angels until I came to the grand crescendo of angelic activity permeating the book of Revelation. I found 234 specific passages about angels, and another 278 times when God is referred to as the Lord of hosts, hosts being the angelic armies of heaven. Angels are referenced in 39 books of the Bible, 19 in the Old Testament, and 20 in the New, and the range of angelic activity spans the Scriptures from Genesis chapter 3, verse 24, to Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. As John Hunter put it, we can as easily think of summer without flowers as of the Bible without angels. As I pondered these passages, I was struck with how matter-of-factly the Bible treats this topic. The Lord doesn't try to convince us of the existence of angels or persuade us of their reality. He doesn't think of them as curious or bizarre creatures as we do, but as a normal part of His created order. In His world, angels are commonplace, a natural part of the environment. The biblical writers understood that there is a spiritual zone surrounding the earth where much unseen angelic and demonic activity exists. Famed pastor Charles Hayden Spurgeon once proclaimed, I do not know how to explain it. I cannot tell how it is, but I believe angels have a great deal to do with the business of this world. In biblical text, angels pop in and out of stories as naturally as we drop into a coffee shop or duck out of an office. They're not mentioned gratuitously. And truth be told, it seems most Bible characters never knowingly saw an angel. Nevertheless, when needed, there they were. Angels comforted Hagar in the desert, delivered Lot from Sodom, guided Israel through the wilderness, fed Elijah under the juniper tree, surrounded Elisha with chariots of fire, saved Hezekiah from Assyria's onslaught, led Isaiah to spiritual commitment, directed Ezekiel into ministry, surrounded Jesus through every phase of His work, bore Lazarus to heaven, delivered Peter from prison, comforted Paul aboard a sinking ship, and gave John a VIP tour of New Jerusalem. To believe the Bible is to believe in angels. Sometimes these heavenly visitants appeared in human form, and sometimes in superhuman splendor. Sometimes they were recognized as supernatural, but on other occasions they appeared as run-of-the-mill strangers. Sometimes the angels appeared in ones or twos, other times in multitudes. Some had wings, others didn't. Sometimes their feet were on the ground. Sometimes they hovered in the sky. Often they materialized in three-dimensional reality, but occasionally they slipped into a person's dreams. Sometimes they were visible, but often they maintained their invisibility. In Revelation chapter 18, verse 1, an angel descended from heaven with such sun-like brilliance that the entire earth was illumined by his splendor. I came away from my study realizing that when God made the cosmos, He created many diverse life forms, fungi and bacteria, plants and animals, fish and birds, humans and angels. To God, Angels are just as conventional as any other creature. They're part of the diversity of life that fills heaven and earth. They are interplanetary creatures who travel easily and instantly between dimensions of reality, between the spiritual and physical realms. They are virtually everywhere, even around me as I write this book and around you as you read it. They comprise our celestial family. As we trace this theme through the Bible, we find angels treated realistically, but not paraded or flaunted. Their existence and enterprises are assumed, and we're assured of their concern for us. But they are never hyper-presented in Scripture. In fact, as my friend Dr. David Jeremiah observed, everything Scripture says concerning angels is in connection with something else as the main theme. There are no pages or passages whose central purpose is to spell out a doctrine of angels. To me, this is an astounding insight that subtly demonstrates the truthfulness of Scripture. If I were composing a supernatural book like a Bible for the ages, if mere humans were putting it together, there would undoubtedly be effusive descriptions and details of these divine agents. But God's Word is written with an economy of words and a logical consistency of method. Nowhere do we find chunks of Scripture singularly devoted to angels. Every reference to angels in the Bible is incidental to a greater topic. Yet, even with this observation, we don't lack for angelic material. Angels are active in Genesis, in various forms at the gates of Eden, to Hagar, to Abraham, to Lot and the inhabitants of Sodom, and to Jacob. After Jacob, there's little mention of angels in the Pentateuch until we encounter the angel of the Lord, who accompanied Israel through the wilderness. And that angel was likely the pre-incarnate Christ himself. Judges has two prominent angel stories. And in subsequent books, there are a few incidents involving angels in the careers of Saul, David, and Solomon. We also have another cluster of angelic sightings during the times of Elijah and Elisha. The Psalms give us a handful of precious verses about angels, though there are few references to angels in Proverbs or the other poetical books in the center of the Bible. Isaiah and Ezekiel had dramatic encounters with angels. The book of Daniel is full of angels, as is Zechariah. Few of the other minor prophets refer to angels. An explosion of angelic activity is connected with the ministry of Christ. Angels are involved in his birth, life, ministry, death, resurrection, ascension, and in the prophecies regarding his second coming. Angels occasionally showed up in the book of Acts with dramatic effect. There are sporadic references in the epistles to angels, giving us some intriguing hints and helps, yet no major passage in Paul's letters provides a systematic teaching about angels. We're given excellent information, however, in the book of Hebrews. The most intense concentration of angelic activity in the Bible is in the book of Revelation, as it discloses their central role in heavenly worship, earthly tribulation, and in the victorious return and reign of Christ. Of course, angelic activity didn't end with the book of Revelation, and the ministry of angels wasn't limited to the days of the Bible. Angels continue their nonstop work on behalf of the saints. Because we have biblical indications that demonic activity will increase as we draw closer to the end of the ages, it's only reasonable to assume the same of angelic enterprises. When I was a student at Columbia International University, my next door.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.